Good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to Oncology Classroom. This month, we are having different talks on pediatric oncology. And as part of that, today evening, we have a talk on pediatric ependymoma, genetics, molecular classifications, and the role of radiation. To take this class, we have Dr. Tanveer Shahid with us, who is a senior consultant radiation oncologist at Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata. Dr. Tanveer Shahid requires no introduction in our class. He has been one of the most wonderful teachers we have, a dedicated academic enthusiast, and a very kind person who spreads his kindness beyond academics. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation. Take all the pain to prepare for this exciting talk and be with us. May I now request you to take over the session and start your lecture. Thank you.
So to begin with, the topic which I was given was basically pediatric ependymoma, genetics, molecular classifications, and role of radiation. So to begin with, I like to also thank Dr. Shantam, actually, who took the pain in preparing a questionnaire, on an app called as Kahoot, he was kind enough even to give marks to all the people who have attempted, and which I'll be sharing in the last, so he really made it interesting. So to begin with, ependymoma as such, it's a challenging tumors to treat, no doubt about it. And the reason simple is that the majority of them, it happens in the children. And again, thing is that the majority of them, they come to the radiation oncologist and eventually they'll be needing radiation. So since they're children, they'll be requiring radiation, and we as a radiation oncologist, we have to give the best. So it's challenging, definitely, because not only about the treatment, but about giving something best and that to the most precious community of the world, that is children. And it definitely it involves the teamwork. My flow of presentations will be like this. I'll take it as it comes, so I'll not read it out. But to begin with, just a simple anatomy, like what do we mean by supratentorial and what do we mean by infratentorial? Anything which is above tentorial cerebral plexus is called a supratentorial, and below that is the infratentorial. Infratentorial basically includes your cerebellum and the posterior fossa, we can say. And what is very interesting that in children, 90% of the ependymomas are infracranial. That is again very important. And in that also, majority of them, it happens in the posterior fossa, that is infratentorial. Only 10% of the children ependymomas can be seen in spinal cord. And again, very important that majority of this infratentorial happens in a very young age group, that is less than 3 years. And in contrast, if you look into the adult, 75% of the ependymomas, they occur in the spinal canal. So if you look at this, a snapshot in the slide, nearly 10% of the all central nervous system and 25% of the all spinal cord tumors eventually, as compared to children as well as adults, is ependymoma. 90% of the ependymomas are intracranial, irrespective of whether it happens, and is so intracranial. And if you look at that also, 2/3 of the patients, again, it happens in the posterior fossa and 1/3 in the supratentorial. Ependymomas are basically, it is a neuroepithelial malignancies of the CNS, and it arises from the neuroaxis, and it arises from the radial glial cells, which happens to be the stem cells. But what is very bad to read this is that 40% of the patients, at the diagnosis, they are incurable. And if you look at the survival, again, 10-year survival is 60%. In adult, it is slightly better. So again, something which we all have to be concerned about. If you look again, majority, as I mentioned, that ependymomas, they do happen in the younger age group, that is below 3 years. And majority of the intracranial ependymomas are definitely, it is relatively, it is uncommon in adult, whereas it is very common in children. But by and large, if you see most of the ependymomas, ultimately it happens below 40 years of age. And that's something to remember. But risk factors, what exactly causes ependymomas, are not well defined. And spinal ependymomas, as I mentioned, it is rare in children. It happens mainly in the adult, and that too at a relatively at a younger age group, 30 to 40 years. And it is mainly, it, if it happens, majority of them are having associated with NF2. Now, look at the WHO classification. It has a very simple classification, just simple, four divisions, and it's based on histology. Grade 1 includes myxopapillary and suburban dymoma. Now, again, somewhere it's a bit confusing. At some places, even WHO has mentioned myxopapillary as even grade 2. So, but grade 1 is myxopapillary and suburban dymoma. Grade 2 is basically the other variants like cellular, papillary, and others. And grade 3, if you look at, it's basically anaplastic variety. And grade 4 are the epidermoplastoma. So, simple 1, 2, 3, and 4. It sounds simple, but if you go on the treatment part, it really doesn't, WHO classification really doesn't hold much importance, actually. You know. So if you look at the myxopapillary ependymoma, it is called a grade 1 or you can say grade 2. And it mostly happens in the adult, in the spinal canal, in the region of cauda equina. And it behaves more like a benign tumor, so with a good prognosis. And subependymoma, definitely it's again, a grade 1 tumor. It's a quite uncommon with an excellent prognosis. If you come at the clinical features of ependymoma, as I told that nearly 2/3 of the intracranial ependymoma in children, it arises from the posterior fossa. And so the symptoms also will be depending upon where it is arising, whether its location is infratentorial or supratentorial. If it is infratentorial, majority of them, it arises from the fourth ventricle. And because of that, there can be features of obstruction, which can lead to the dilatation of the ventricles, leading to obstructive hydrocephalus, and which will be having the features of a raised intracranial pressure. We know what are the symptoms of raised intracranial pressure. If there is a brainstem invasion, the symptoms of brainstem invasion will come, like loss of balance, ataxia, brainstem, you know, host of vital structures are present in the brainstem. And what's important to know that if it is supratentorial, then the scissors is one of the common clinical features which we'll encounter. Coming on to the radiological finding, before MRI, I'll go to the CT. CT is something which is again common. Now, it is the common investigation done everywhere and probably the first investigations, though MRI is a standard. CT scan, I just mentioned the important point that calcification, if it is present within the tumor, which is located in the fourth ventricle. I mentioned fourth ventricle because majority of the tumors will arise from the infratentorial region, which is the fourth ventricle. So if there is a calcification located within the tumor in the fourth ventricle, it will be highly suggestive of ependymoma. But again, something which is not diagnostic, but it will definitely be suggestive. Coming on to the MRI features, if MRI features very important, it's hypointense on T1 and hyperintense on T1. Majority of the tumors are infratentorial, that is in from the fourth ventricle, so which will be leading to the dilatations of the ventricles. So again, you can see the hydrocephalus, which can be seen over here. And this is because of the obstructions of the fourth ventricle because of the growing mass. Very important point, again, which will be differentiating from other tumors, that despite being a considerable big size of the tumor, still you don't see a peritumoral edema, which we have to keep in mind. Now, DWI, that is diffusion-weighted ependymomas, often they exhibit a restricted diffusion. And again, something very important to note that MRS is not characteristic, which is again a very important tool for seeing other varieties of tumors, particularly the high-grade tumors. And what is another point to be note, which we'll have to keep it in mind, that since this tumor arises from the posterior fossa, they can enter into the cervical region. And that can happen through the foramen of Lushka and foramen of Magendie, again, which is commonly observed. Now, we'll also see the differential diagnosis because there are the other tumors which can arise from the posterior fossa. They can be medulloblastoma, pilocytic astrocytoma, embryonal tumors, choroid plexus tumors, even other supratentorial, it can be gliomas or the choroid plexus or papilloma. So why this differential diagnosis is important is not that every child which comes with a posterior fossa tumor will be having a medulloblastoma or a ATRT or a or a pilocytic. So other differential diagnosis has to be kept in mind, and that happens to be ependymoma. And though for any brain tumor, histopathology is the standard for final diagnosis, but radiologically also you can get an idea. For example, if you see the ependymomas, it arises most commonly from the posterior fossa and that too from the fourth ventricle. And is often it is accompanied by restricted diffusion on DWI. This is something which we have to keep it in mind. There is a restricted diffusion. And this again, it differentiates ependymoma from post-pilocytic astrocytoma, because in pilocytic, there is no restricted diffusion that has to be kept in mind. Other thing is that some patients' ependymomas extend down from the posterior fossa to the cranial cervical junction, as I mentioned, and that is very rare in the other posterior fossa tumors. So it can be seen in the ependymomas, but not in the other posterior fossa tumors. And how can this happen? It happens from the foramen of Loeschka and foramen of Magendie, which is which will not be seen in the other posterior fossa tumor, that is medulloblastoma. And if the extension happens, it is also called as plastic ependymoma. So these are some of the things. So if you quickly recall, DWI is restricted, MRS is not something very important, T1 is hypo-intense, T2 is hyper-intense, there is no peritumoral edema. So this has to be kept in mind. And because of the posterior fossa, there has been obstructive hydrocephalus. So these are some of the things which you'll have to keep it in mind. How will we evaluate if a patient is suspected to be ependymoma? Of course, after the history, the radiology, that is, and not only the local imaging only of the brain, but also of the spine, that to be the contrast. 10% of the patients can have a leptomeningeal spread, which is of course it is quite late, but still lumbar puncture is to see whether there is a CSF spread or not. And if you are planning for a CSF examination, it has to be ideally done pre-operatively. We all know that. And again, something which is very basic, everybody knows that it is contraindicated in the case of obstructive hydrocephalus, because it will be causing a brain herniation. And if you are doing on a post-op basis, then don't do before 10 days, because it will be giving a spurious or a false positive reports. Coming on to pathology, again, something which I'll spend a minute over here. In pathology, I mean, though it looks complicated, but it's very simple. We have to just remember certain terms. One term, particular term is very important, is called as ependymal rosettes. Now, if a pathologist sees an ependymal rosettes, he can, straight away, he can go and brand it as a ependymoma. So it is a pathognomonic. But what's the irony is that it is not commonly seen. So if by chance, if ependymal rosettes are seen, it will be pathognomonic of ependymoma. That is something very important. Other thing is that not ependymal rosettes, but a perivascular pseudorosis. I mean, perivascular pseudorosis are again commonly seen in ependymoma, but they are not pathognomonic. So that's again important. But here's something extremely important to note, that there will be inside the cytoplasm, there can be a dots, which is called as intracytoplasmic micro rosettes. And if this is seen, again, it goes in the favor of ependymoma. If you look at the IHC, all these markers at the GFAP, EMA, S100, bimentin, and oligo 2, this has to be done. But coming on to this, which is again very, very important, is that in posterior fossa lesion, we should also do something called as H3K27 trimethylation. And it is done by IHC, H3K27 trimethylation. And again, this H3K27 trimethylation is commonly seen in the posterior fossa A type of ependymoma. Now, what is PFA type of ependymoma? I'll come in my subsequent slides. And again, especially for my younger enthusiastic budding colleagues, I should say that is H3K27 mutations are also seen in brainstem glioma. But this H3K27 is different from the H3K27 trimethylation. So we don't have to confuse that these two are seen. In posterior fossa A type of pneumoma, we see H3K27 trimethylation. And in brainstem glioma, we just see H3K27 mutation, which is indicator of a bad prognosis of brainstem glioma. So this is a pathology. Now here, if you can see, when Dodul gave me the responsibility of molecular classification, if I just present this slide, I think my job will be done, and I can even start discussing with you all on an interactive basis, because this happens to be the heart of my entire presentation, if you see. See, molecular classification, don't get confused by this. It looks a jugglery, but it's very, very simple. Just listen, concentrate for the next 1 or 2 minutes. I'll try to make it simple. We all know that ependymoma can be infratentorial or it can be supratentorial. No doubt about it. We do agree and we all remember. So for the time being, just forget the supratentorial part. Let's content on the infratentorial. And why to concentrate infratentorial? Because 75% of the ependymoma, they arise from here. So when we say about infratentorial, we are having two terms, that is PFA and PFB. PFA means posterior fossa A and PFB means posterior fossa B. Now, let's take one by one. If you find a young child less than 3 years and probably male, and you can straight away, you can take it as a PFA type. That means younger, less than 3 years of age, with a male preponderance, you can straight away, you can brand it to be called as a PFA type. Upon that, the icing on the cake can be that if IHC says that there is an H3K27 trimethylation, your job is done. This is a PFA type. So, simple, young child, less than 3, male probably, H3K27 trimethylation, it is PFA. Now, what is PFB? Any older children, that is posterior fossa tumor, but again, the age is older child or teenager, then there is less chance that can be PFA. Then it will become PFB. So this is the way you can differentiate it. Okay, so PFA younger and trimethylation, and PFB older and with equal sex preponderance. So this is PFA and PFB. Now let's concentrate on supratentorial. In supratentorial, as I mentioned in my quiz also, again, people who have done, thanks a lot. The people who have not done, again, it's not to worry. This again, I'll try to just, you have to just remember this, these two terms. What is called as Rella fusion. Nice name to remember, Rella fusion. Another is called as YAP1 fusion. Okay, so Rella fusion and YAP1 fusion is seen in the supratentorial varieties of ependymoma. And it is seen in the older children. So Rella fusion is seen in the older children. In contrast, YAP1 fusion is seen in the younger children. That's the thing. So again, to make it as a revision basis, infratentorial, supratentorial. Infratentorial PFA, PFB. PFA, young child, less than 3 years, probably male, with H3K27 trimethylation, straight away I'll call it as a PFA. Any posterior fossa tumor, but the child age is older or a teenager. So I will, even before getting my histopathology or my other reports, I can have an idea that this will be a posterior fossa B tumor. And if I get a supratentorial tumor on my radiology, and if the child is older, then I'll have a good chance that this can be a Rella fusion. That will be the Rella fusion. And this all has been, this molecular subgrouping, and it is based on the methylation status actually. And YAP1 fusion, again, if the child is young, that is less than 3 years, but the tumor is supratentorial, I will be going that this will be a YAP1 fusion. Okay. Now, just to add beyond that, now, in this, there are certain goods and certain bads. So I'll say what is good and what is bad. Posterior fossa A type of tumor has a poor prognosis. Rella fusion type has a poor prognosis. Rest all will have a good prognosis. So on molecular classification, we are having three sites of ependymoma. As I told in my first slides, there is a supratentorial, then there is a posterior fossa, which is infratentorial, and there can be a spinal. So these are three. So these are the three sites where ependymoma can happen. In these three sites, again, 3 multiplied by 3 will have 9. So there is a 9 molecular subgrouping based on the methylation status. So supratentorial is having 3. Posterior fossa is again having 3 subgroup, and spine is also having 3 subgroup. We are not dealing with the spine today. So we are just dealing with the supratentorial and the infratentorial, and that too related to the children. Now, again, it is very, very simple, because two things we can again remove. In supratentorial, there is a subependymoma type, which is again, as I told in my third or fourth slide, that this is the behave in a benign fashion. It's a grade 1 tumor. And that also it is seen in the posterior fossa also. There is a subependymoma, again, it's a grade 1. So we are left with what? Supratentorial ependymoma YAC1, supratentorial ependymoma RELA. So RELA, it is seen in comparatively older children and a poor prognosis. YAC1 is comparatively seen in younger children with a good prognosis. Okay. In the posterior fossa, if you say again, the PFA type and PFB type. PFA is seen in younger children, less than 3 years, bad prognosis. PFB type, that is again, comparatively older children and teenagers, it's a good prognosis. Even now you can try to correlate even with all those diagrams. So it's simple, easy to understand. Infra, supra, PFA, PFB, PFA, bad, PFB, good. Supratentorial, RELA, bad, and older children, YAP1, good, younger children. Even if I forget everything, I'll again, some very silly nonsense mnemonic, which I have tried to recover. Posterior, so infratentorial, actually this much we can remember, posterior fossa A and B, and RELA, in supratentorial, RELA and YAP, if you can remember. So PFA, here there is an A, and in RELA also this is A, AA, these are bad. So this one we can say to try it simplified. So I hope I am trying to simplify it. Now, if you look at this paper by Partler in 2015, and he has done an enormous work as far as the molecular subtyping is concerned. And again, to repeat what I had said, spine is having 3 subgroup, posterior fossa is having 3 subgroup, and supratentorial is having 3 subgroup. Very easy. All the subgroup is having a subependymoma, 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 subependymoma. So these three are good prognosis, we'll remove it. So now what is left with A and B, that is PFA and PFB, and YAP1 and RELA. So RELA is bad. So that's one thing. So RELA is bad. So here we can see the survival is poor. And again, other thing is that E, that is PFA, that is PFA, that is also bad. And you can see the survival is again poor. And age distribution wise, PFA is in younger age group and RELA is comparatively in the older age group. Again, in the next slide, I have tried to further simplify. Okay, supra, posterior fossa and spinal. Supra is also having 3 subgroup. Posterior fossa having 3 subgroup. Okay. And spinal is also having 3 plus 3 plus 3 is equal to 9. Okay, isn't it? Now, what are the bad prognostic group? As I told, supratentorial, ependymoma, RELA, poor prognosis. PFA, poor prognosis. Rest, everything is a good prognosis. I hope it is clear. Somebody can just unmute and say it is clear. If it is not clear, I can take another 1 minute of here. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. It is. Yes, sir. It is clear.
Thank you, Arunjithi. Thank you so much. So if you'll just look at the poor prognosis wise, the supratentorial RELA is poor and posterior fossa A is poor. So that's the thing. You know, if you try to really understand this by reading it, it becomes very difficult. But if you just listen to this, supratentorial RELA poor, PFA poor, rest everything is good. Okay. So coming on to the quiz question, can anybody, Debanjan, Taruni, Neelam, anybody can take it, because these are the numbers, names what I remember. So anyone can take. This is the quiz what I had put. Look at the figure above, which represents 4 molecular subtypes of ependymoma, and mark which type of molecular subtype has the poor prognosis in the terms of survival.
Sir, E.
Answer is?
E.
Absolutely right. So supratentorial RELA, poor. YAP1, good. posterior fossa A poor and PFB good. So what is left? A plus C. Isn't it so simple? Yes. Now, if you come at the molecular classification, the consensus, what is important is that, I'll not go into this, we have already dealt. What is important is that the WHO grading 2 and 3 might not really decide upon my treatment. That is one thing. So what we need is a molecular subtype. In molecular subtype also, the supratentorial and the posterior fossas are distinct. They are separate and they are prognostically also separate. And so every patient who undergoes a surgery, his or her, the histopathology, the fresh frozen tumor should be sent for the molecular subtyping. That is the consensus statement, again from the Partlers paper in 2015. Apart from WHO, my younger colleagues should also remember something called a C-impact. C-impact is not an official version of WHO, but we all have to remember it is consortium to inform molecular and practical approaches to CNS tumor. And now update 7 is going on, and which has specifically come for ependymomal tumors. See impact. Again, I'll not go into the details. Again, it is divided supratentorial, posterior fossa, and spinal cord into different types. What is again, it is important to note that they have dropped the something called as classical and anaplastic ependymoma. They don't try to include it. They haven't included. WHO grade 2 has been graded as mixopapillary type. And if you really don't know the molecular status, then mark it as grade 2 to grade 3. That is something which comes from the C impact. So till here, if you again try to revise it, molecular classification of ependymoma, and also there's a very famous trial which will come later, ACNS 121. This slide has come before. In fact, it should have gone later. You know, I'm sorry for that. Anyway, I'll read it. Since it has come, I'll just say why this is important. This slide is important. Like you might not specifically, my younger colleague should not confuse. Dr. Tanvi is told that EPN RELA is a bad prognosis and PFA is a bad prognosis. So this is what I told, and I stand by it. And this is science, what it says. But why it is different is that this ACNS 121, which is the, I can say it is the biggest landmark trial could be done in one of the biggest, I cannot say biggest, one of the biggest prospective study done in ependymoma by Thomas E. Merchant from the St. Jude's group. Now, in this particular trial, what they found was that in spite of having a RELA fusion, there was no difference in outcome as compared to the YAP1 variety. So that's the reason I wanted to put it over here. Similarly, posterior fossa A, again, it is supposed to be a poor prognosis. But in ACNS 121 by Thomas Merchant, again, they did not come to a conclusion that PFA and PFBs are separate and PFA is bad. I mean, that was not particularly from this paper. It did not come as a bad prognostic group. So that's the difference. We do know that RELA is bad. We do know that PFA is bad. But in this particular trial, ACNS 121, it was not found to be bad. In fact, in PFA, it went one step ahead and said that if PFA also has a 1Q gain, then only it is bad. And PFB, what we always call good, 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 but it is not always good. There is something called as if there is a posterior fossa B with a 13Q loss, is again poor outcome. So I'll again elaborate in my subsequent slides. Okay. So there are certain unresolved molecular markers, and particularly what I mean to say is that 1Q gain, as I told, that it is seen in PFA, and it is supposed to be a bad prognostic outcome, but how bad it is, we don't know. Again, my younger colleagues can ask ependymoma, if it is a RELA, we call it as a bad. But what about if the RELA is not seen? Can it become good? I don't have an answer. Similarly, YAP1 fusion is good. So if YAP1 fusion is not seen, can it become bad? Again, that is not clear. So if there is no RELA fusion, is it a good prognosis? We don't have an answer. Starting onto the treatment, everything again starts with surgery. You want to get a maximal safe resection. After that, what you want? you have to go for adjuvant treatment, and that will be decided upon what kind of a histopathology as well as what is the stratification. And then the role of adjuvant chemotherapy is basically after surgery, it is seen in the younger age group, particularly less than 3 years or even less than 1 year, just to delay radiation. However, it did not prove to have any kind of a survival benefit. So before going on to the surgical part, we all have to understand there are certain terms called as, and this is very, very important for ependymoma, which we'll have to remember. It is a gross tumor resection 1, 2. Then there's a near total resection and a subtotal resection. I'll start from the last one. Subtotal resection, we all know that I could not resect it out totally, and I have left a tumor which is greater than 0.5 centimeter on imaging. So that's called a subtotal. Near total means I went ahead, I did it nearly total. So it is less than 0.5 centimeters. So that means my residual is less than 0.5 centimeters. This is STR and NTR. Then I'll go to the simplest one, gross total resection 1. GTR 1 means I have taken out everything, and even on imaging or on operating microscope, nothing could be seen. That is GTR 1. And what is GTR 2? This is the confusing one, but again, simple is that I have taken out everything. My imaging is not showing any evidence of the tumor, but in the microscope still I could see something. So only by microscope you could see. So that is GTR2. So again, a simplest thing, the worst variety of surgery can be subtotal, and the best variety will be called as GTR, that is GTR1. And this will be a backbone of ACNS 121 trial. So we'll have to keep it in mind, GTR1 and 2, NTR and STR. So after that, I'll not be repeating these terms again, that what does it mean? We'll have to just remember. So best is GTR1 and the worst is the STR. And so to start with the treatment, if we see, the surgery happens to be the most important prognostic factor. When I call it surgery, it is the extent of surgery. GTR, if you are able to do, you will get a advantage in the terms of survival as compared to STR. And if you do a GTR and then you give radiation upon that, so all these patients who are receiving RT, again your survival is even better. So important thing is GTR, that is gross total resection, followed by RT. That is something which will have a great impact on the outcome. And this is from the SEER analysis of almost, we can say, 3 decades of analysis. This one was the result. Again, I particularly made this slide because when we think in the terms of this beautiful population of our world, that is children, that too giving a radiation, it's like a paradox. And the paradox why we say that we want to avoid radiation, and we all know being a radiation oncologist that what impact it can have if you're giving radiation to the brain. And we also know that it can cause secondary malignancies, there will be growth disturbance, and so many different functional outcomes. I mean, there will be a decreased functional outcome. But still, radiation therapy is a very important tool as far as treatment of ependymoma is concerned. Therefore, it's like a paradox, but we'll have to be careful while giving radiation. So I'll start before going on to the ACNS trial, actually 121, which is the biggest landmark trial, one of the biggest landmark trial. Before that, again, from Thomas Merchant from St. Jude's, published way back in JCO in 2004, where 88 patients were included. And why this trial was important, because look at the median mean age group. It was less than 3 years. Because before that, it was thought that you should not ideally give radiation to the younger age group. Now, this was the first study, a prospective one, where less than 3 years of age was included in the beginning. And what was important that if you can give radiation to this group also, you have a good survival outcome, which can be seen even after 6 and 7 years. The main concern was the neurocognitive or the IQ part. If you compare the IQ of children of more than 3 years versus less than 3 years, definitely the IQ of less than 3 years will be less, but still it is gradually recovering. And we can say at one point of time, it can be comparable. So it's not that you cannot give radiation to less than 3 years of age. Now, this particular trial gave this message that survival increases, and even IQ is something, it remains stable as far as the neurocognitive outcome is concerned. I really get fascinated because we all know that he is this gentleman, Thomas Merchant from St. Jude's, and what he has done, I mean, he has done enormous work in the pediatric tumors, particularly medulloblastomas and ependymomas. And this is the trial which was talking about ACNS-121. And ACNS basically deals with the conformal radiation therapy for pediatric ependymomas, chemotherapy for incompletely resected ependymoma. This is a big heading. As I go forward, I'll deal it. You know what does it really mean. So, in this particular slide again, I'll want everybody to just pay an attention. ACNS-121, as a time and again I'm mentioning, it is one of the biggest landmark trial. It divided its population into four groups. So there was strata 1, 2, 3, and 4, and it was based on certain things. What was a certain thing? It was based on the surgery, WHO grade and site, and that will decide upon the treatment. So let's take the strata 1. In strata 1, it was a gross tumor resection done, and the site was supratentorial, and it was a WHO grade 2. So if the supratentorial tumor with a gross tumor resection 1, that means nothing can be seen in imaging or microscope, and if it is WHO grade 2, don't do anything, just observe this patient after surgery. Now, let's come to the, I'll skip this 2 and I'll come to 3 and 4 before coming to 3. The strata 3 and strata 4, which included the maximum number of patients. Now, if you look at the strata 3, the kind of surgery was near total resection. That means less than 0.5 centimeters tumor left behind, or a GTR2. Again, I'm repeating, GTR2 is something not seen on imaging but can be seen on microscopy. And if it is WHO2 and 3, whatever site it is, you have to give radiation. And the strata 4 was that you did an excellent surgery, that is GTR1. And if your supratentorial is 3, it's not 2. If it have been 2, then it will be observation, but it's a supratentorial grade 3 or infratentorial 2 and 3, these patients will be receiving radiation. So this is something, it's laid an algorithm that which patient will be requiring radiation. The most poorest quality or the most adverse outcome was seen in this particular group where there was a subtotal resection done, and WHO grade 2 or 3, whatever sites any. So you have left a tumor which is more than 0.5 centimeters behind. So after the surgery, don't take straight away for radiation. Go for chemotherapy first. Downstage it, if possible, go for second surgery and then go for radiation. So this is something important. Hope I am clear. GTR, supratentorial, grade 2, nothing to be done. But in if it is NTR or GTR, and if it is 2 or 3, whatever site it is, you will have to give radiation. And why it is important? Because look at it, NTR and GTR, that means you have 0.5, that means here GTR 2 means on microscopy you can see something, and near total means it is less than 0.5 mm. So some residual is left behind. Whatever grade it is, you go ahead and give radiation. Even if you have done the greatest of the surgeries, but if it is supratentorial 3 or infratentorial 2 and 3, again you will have to give radiation. And the worst was this one. So event-free survival and overall survival is definitely better with the GTR or STR followed by radiotherapy. And so that was the thing, you know. So if we look at here, in this particular slide, this was the S1, that is strata 1, where there was a supratentorial tumor and it was a grade 2. And I had just observed the 5 years and seven years event-free survival was this much, and it's good. But if you look at the strata 3 and strata 4, I mean strata 3 and strata 4 is, again, we all remember it was a NTR or GTR. And if it's an infratentorial, it could be grade 2 or grade 3. And if it is supratentorial, it is grade 3. After that, I have given radiation. So still, my EFS and my at the end of 5 years and 7 years, still it is good. But the worst was on this one. I have done a supratentorial resection, that is subtotal resection. So significant amount of tissues were left behind. And after that, I could not give radiation. I could go for chemotherapy or second surgery was possible or not. And you had a very poor outcome. So important thing is that you have to give radiation after a good surgery, that will have a good outcome. If you look at a very simple plane, if you see which has done the best, if you, or you can say the event-free survival, if you look at it, The best one comes from the strata 1 or 4 or 3. 1, 4, 3, we all remember. 1 is again supratentorial, grade 2. And we did not do anything. We just had observed. 3 and 4, again, we do. It was NTR or GTR. And radiation was immediately given. Now, why this slide is important is that grade 1 is good. There are only 11 patients. No, we did not give radiation. But bulk of the patients were from strata 3 and strata 4. And they all received immediate post-op RT. And that had led to the better event-free survival. And grade 2, if you see, you did a subtotal resection. You went for chemotherapy. Surgery was, again, second surgery possible or not possible. Radiation was delayed. You had a poor event-free survival. So that was the that is the message from this particular slide. And again, why we all get fascinated by ACNS 121, because this was our landmark slides, which we had posted last week. And I'll just concentrate on this. This particular ACNS 121, it can be called as a trial of first, you know. These are the first study which really took into account that a supratentorial with a great tumors can be observed. This was again a first trial, which also came that if you do an STR, don't straight away go for radiation, give chemotherapy, and again try for second surgery before RT. And again, it was also radiation was also given in the children below 3 years in a very organized fashion. And also, this was a trial which even came out with that what should be the CTV margin for radiation. So this is the importance of this ACNS 121. It was from the Children Oncology Group from the St. Jude's by Thomas Merchant. So it's really a very, very important trial. So let's come to the lessons learned. Again, what is important that we are comparing with the present study that is ACNS 121, whether it is less than 3 years or more than 3 years. In ACNS 121, strata 3 and 4, they received after surgery radiation. So whether it is less than 3 years or more than 3 years, your results were good. Now, what if you compare it with the historical control that POG9233 or CCG9942, these were the trials where radiation was not given. In this POG9233, there was a dose intensification chemotherapy after surgery. And you look at the event-free survival or the OS, it's poor. That means radiation was not given. And again over here, radiation was delayed and again the outcome is poor. So what's important is that whether age less than 3 or more than 3, good surgery followed by radiation will have a good outcome. So that's something. Again, needless to mention, as I told, extent of resection, if you do a GTR1, you get an excellent EFS and as well as OS. So the again, very important, as I mentioned, time and again, I am saying that extent of surgery is a very important prognostic factor as far as the outcome is concerned. Look at the impact of age. We all know that younger children will definitely do bad as compared to the older children. And that can be seen that in the 5-year EFS or OS, the older children, that is more than 3 years, are doing better as compared to 3 years. Now, this should not be confused that in this group, radiation is not working. The thing is that in spite of radiation, as compared to the older age group of children, your EFS and OS is less in the younger age group. That's the thing. That this is something again, as I told that though the grades are not important, but still there is an impact of grade if you can see. And this decides upon the treatment, and that is the reason why it is important. And if you look at that strata 3 and strata 4, just now we saw that in strata 3 and strata 4, where NTR, that is near total resection, or GTR is done, and in them, basing on your grading, I mean, if your grading, I mean, if it is a EFS, if you look at over here, if it is a younger, I mean, if it's a grade 2 or the classical ependymoma, your again EFS is better as compared to the grade 3, that is the anaplastic variety. So that's the thing. Okay. So grades are still important. The higher the grade, the poorer the prognosis. And impact of molecular subtype on the outcome in ependymoma, this is something, as I mentioned in my slide where I told that in ACNS 121, RELA fusion was seen in 77% of the supratentorial tumors. But what was very important is that there was no significant difference in the EFS, OS, and that is against the scientific notion, because we knew that relapsation is poor, but that was not seen in ACNS 1-2-1. So that was something important to note. Again, I'll quote another paper from this is the NCI study from Ontario, where like in this particular study, relapsation is seen in the supratentorial. We all know RELA supratentorial. Now there is something infratentorial also. In infratentorial, we have a PFA and we have a PFB. We all remember that PFA has a poor prognosis as compared to PFB. And this particular trial, that is from NCI study from Ontario, exactly proved the same thing, that PFA has a poor prognosis in the terms of PFS and OS. So it is doing poorly. The PFA is doing poorly. So this was already, it was again, this trial was published a couple of years back, and which said that PFA is bad. But in contrast, the ACNS 121 says that whether it's a PFA and PFB subgroup, there is no difference as far as EFS or OS is concerned. Now, however, this has to be taken with a pinch of salt, because the numbers were not powered enough to see that difference. But still, it gave an indication that PFA and PFB is not only the thing, there is something beyond that. But again, for my younger colleagues, I'll repeat, RELA is bad, PFA is bad, okay? Now, if you look at, again, in ACNS 121, what was important that, okay, PFA and PFB, there is no significant impact as far as EFS and OS is concerned. Clear? But very important point which came from this was that if there is a 1Q gain in PFA, then you have a poor outcome. So we went ahead, one step ahead, that it is not only the PFA and PFB which has to be decided, but PFA, it is bad provided it also has a 1Q gain. Then it is, you can say it's bad. So if you see PFA, you will again have to go and do a 1Q gain. So to say it, that is really bad, okay? So if in PFA, it's not only the PFA and PFB which will matter, but the 1Q gain. So if a PFA tumor, PFA variety has a 1Q gain, you have a more chance of having a local failure and you have a more chance of having a distant failure. So this has to be kept in mind. Okay, PFA is bad, but upon that, if it's a 1Q gain, it can be said it's really bad, okay? Now, PFB. So again, I'll repeat it for my budding younger colleagues that supratentorial, RELA is bad. YAP1 is good. Infratentorial, posterior fossa, PFA and PFB. PFA is bad. PFB is good. But when I say PFA is bad, it's not only the because of PFA, it is also if you can add 1Q gain. So now from PFA to PFB, as I told that PFB is good. So this paper, again, it was published last year itself, in which they had seen that PFB, when we say it's good, it's not a blanket statement. There is again a heterogeneity in this, PFB is good. Now, why this is so? That in PFB, this 1Q gain is not a robust marker. This 1Q gain can be said for PFA, but not for PFB. So for PFB, what is important is the 13Q loss. So we all know that 1Q and 13Q loss is not only seen in ependymoma, it is also seen in the lymphomas and multiple myelomas and smoldering myelomas, you know. So what is important that if PFB, as a general blanket scientific statement, we can say that PFB is good. But if PFB is having 13Q loss, then again it becomes bad. My younger colleagues might be thinking that why Dr. Tanvir is confusing. Once you said that PFA is good and PFA is bad and PFB is good, isn't that enough? No, it is not enough, because as we saw in the ACNS 121, if it is supratentorial tumor, if it is grade 2, you, and if it is a GTR1, you are observing. So similarly, the excitement built up that if a PFB is a good variety of tumor, do we really have to add adjuvant radiotherapy? So is it that it's good so we can avoid adjuvant RT? valid question, but the issue will be that if you are really wanting to avoid adjuvant RT in PFB, thinking that it is good, go ahead and do a 13Q loss. And if there is a 13Q loss, that means despite being good, it is not really good. So in these patients, you'll have to consider for adjuvant RT. And that was the reason why this heterogeneity in PFB was taken into account, that can we avoid RT in the PFEPNB type, that is PFB type. So PFA is poor, PFB is good. But PFA with 1Q loss is really bad, really poor. And PFB, despite being good, if there is a 13Q loss, it is not that good. Okay. Coming on to ACNS 831, this is an ongoing trial which is just looking into the what is the role of maintenance chemotherapy, and we'll have to wait for the result. Coming on to the radiation doses, again, standard dose, what we practice, the dose depends upon where, what is the kind of surgery it has been done, and also what is the age of the child what we are treating, that will decide upon. But by and large, what we practice, the 54 gray 259.4, and we all know it's by conformal RT, and your GTV usually includes the post-op tumor bed with a residual tumor. CTV in ACNS 121 was 1 centimeter, and PTV was 3 to 5 mm, and usual doses was 59.4, but if there was a younger age group, they had given 54 gray. Okay. And there are these other trials apart from ACNS, that is St. Jude's and ACNS 831, where the difference basically lies over here, that the CTV margin from 1 centimeter is 0.5 centimeter. So to remember, 54 gray is the minimum what we have to give. Okay. Now, if you look at this paper, which was published again from the same great man, I mean, sorry for the spelling mistake, from Thomas Merchant in JCO in 2004, where basically it was a prospective study where 74 out of 88 patients underwent a gross total resection. And in spite having a gross total resection in such a large number, still a higher dose was given, that is 59.4 gray, and that led to a good progression free survival. So this is something that, in spite of having a good resection, still it is preferable at times to give a higher dose. There are other fractionation, pediatric oncology group published a couple of years back, in which it was basically the treatment was given by hyperfractionation, and this was the dose what was given. And PSIOP, it went one step forward, and it was published in Neuro-Oncology in a couple of years back, where they had gone under dose escalation at 59.4 gray followed by 8 gray 2 fraction as a boost, you know. So that was the thing. Again, it is something, it's a dose escalation trial. But from the National Cancer Database study, what was seen that dose escalation really did not translate into an overall survival benefit. And there is no data regarding the local control, which should ideally be the robust endpoint. But however, we have to understand that this is a database compilation. So we are not sure about the dose, but one thing we are sure about, that 54 gray is the minimum what we have to give. And if it's an older patient, you can go for 59 gray. Now, if you are giving a higher dose, are we really bothered about brainstem? Because I'm sure my younger colleagues, again, Neelam, Taruni, and Riddhi, everybody will just say, what would be the brainstem dose? Isn't that something which have to keep in mind? Now, if you look at the contact paper published in Red Journal almost a decade back, which was specifically for infratentorial ependymomas. And what is very interesting to see over here is that, look at the percentage volume which is getting more than 58 gray and more than 60 gray. It is this volume. So quite a high volume is included in the high dose region. And with this St. Jude's contact paper published almost a decade back, what is important, that it is safe to give even a higher dose, because our main concern is the brainstem, which was, again, this paper is important because it specifically deals with the infratentorial ependymoma. So it is not only the dose what we are looking at, it is also at the end, Some other factors, like if you look at apart from the dose, what are the other factors is which is important for brainstem toxicity? At 1 year, if you look, it's basically the gender and your GTV volume. At 2 years, how many times the resection has been done? Because we know that ependymomas will have a recurrence and these patients can undergo a resurgery. So number of resections are important. And at the 5 years, your CSF shunting, your GTV volume. So it's not only the dose what we're looking at. There are other host of other factors which has to be seen as far as the brainstem toxicity is concerned. Again, from the same contact paper published by Thomas Merchant almost a decade back in Red Journal, in which the conclusion was very bold that incomplete recovery of the brainstem function is related to surgical mobility and the volume and extent of the tumor. It is not the dose what we're looking, the volume, the mobility, and the extent of the tumor which will be deciding. So that has to be kept in mind. So when we are talking about the morbidity, we all have to think about the proton, because we know what the proton can do specifically for children. And specifically in ependymoma, proton has a big role to play. And we all know why it is so, because of your hypothalamic dose, your pituitary doses. And what will happen if that doses cannot be taken into control? We can have all this functional deficits. So this has been seen in multiple studies. I'll not go into the details. I always get fascinated by the Indian studies. This again study by our teacher for all of us from Tata Memorial, Dr. Rakesh Jalali, in which a dose constraint model to predict neuroendocrine dysfunction in young patients with brain tumors. This was a prospective study. And what was important, because this was a pediatric young patients, and they suggested that hypothalamus pituitary axis doses of less than 27 gray will minimize the risk of post-RT neuroendocrine deficit. So that has to be kept in mind. Again, this paper was published just last year. Again, by Dr. Tejpal Gupta, published just this year in 2020. This was basically, this is a paper again, which it was a retrospective study, and it basically it dealt with that in ependymoma patients, when they have a recurrence, you undergo a re-excision and re-radiation. So what is the outcome in this? It was a retrospective study of 55 patients. Median age was 10 years. What included is a comparatively children, but relatively older age group. And the period of study was a retrospective study, and this was the time frame where they included their patient. It is very nice because they have given the finally what should be the recommendation. The recommendation says that if there is a recurrence, go ahead and do a surgical re-excision aggressively. Re-radiation should be offered early after resurgery. Focal radiation is an option, or if there's an isolated distant relapse, again a focal radiation. But what is very, very important is this line. CSI should be considered with focal boost to the recurrent tumor bed, even in localized relapse. So we should not just get away thinking that there's a focal RT will be enough. If there's a recurrence in ependymoma, think of a CSI that should ideally be the treatment protocol for the radiation. And if there is a metastatic or a disseminated disease, entire neuroaxis radiation, neuroaxial radiation has to be given, that is CSI. And your recurrent tumor bed dose, it has to be somewhere between 50 to 55 with a cumulative dose of 100 to 110 EQD2. And we should not encourage this particular treatment at a systemic chemotherapy just to delay the re-radiation and to buy time, because this can be detrimental to survival. So this is something, again, very important from this paper. So if we come to the conclusion of the papers, you know, if you look at it to conclude, there is an impact of post-operative radiation. Most important factor is the surgery, and we have to get a GTR, and this will have a great impact on the outcome. your grade, your age, your molecular classifications are very, very important, and it's already been discussed. Again, I'll repeat once more, a supratentorial, infratentorial, supratentorial, RELA fusion, YAP1 fusion. RELA fusion is bad, YAP1 fusion is good. Posterior fossa, PFA, PFB. PFA is bad, PFB is good. PFB becomes even more bad if there's a 1q loss. PFB is not that good if there is a 13q loss. So it's like a poem. Radiation dose and volume minimum is 54 gray what we want. That is something it has to be given, and you can even go ahead to give till 60 gray. And your technique is very, very important. Conformal or intensity modulated proton therapy is definitely preferable even in ACNS protocol. Nearly, I think, 18 to 19 patients were treated on protons. However, because of the non-availability, patients could not be taken. But proton therapy preferable in primary setting, and definitely for the re-radiation setting, definitely. And in recurrent setting after surgery, CSI is preferable to the full dose, and do not delay the radiation. And I'm ever indebtful to all the people who listen in the evening of Saturday. I'm really impressed. I mean, how can you give time? Because it's really very difficult, but thank you all. Dr. Dedodul specifically, who has created this amazing platform. Srinivas, whom I always look upon whenever I talk on anything on CNS, and of course these two gentlemen, Dr. Rakesh Jalali and Tejpal Gupta, who happens to be the teacher, and she'll ever remain my teacher because she taught me the ABC, and Santam, who made this on Kahoot platform. It is something amazing. Dudul, I'll take another 2-3 minutes because Santam has
given... Absolutely, sir. We are all waiting for the quiz result.
Okay, so that's the thing. So Dr. Santam has really made it really very, very interesting. And this is my I get emotional when I see them because they help me so much. Congratulations to Rishav. I mean, he passed his DNB yesterday. Great effort. And Pavitra and Ashish are going to appear next month. So all the best to them. And Riddhi is again leaving us for Tata Memorial. He's going next month. So all the best to him. And rest everybody who helped me out. So coming on to the Dr. Shantam's Kahoot, I mean, these were the things where the problem, I mean, Shantam has given that where the maximum people have done the mistake. So anybody can unmute and say, which of the following is true about molecular profiling of ependymoma? DNA methylation profiling is used to define subtypes. YAP1 and RELA fusion characterized different subgroups. Patient with PFA and ST-RELA have a dismal prognosis. Molecular risk stratification is superior to histological grading. So what is true? Anybody? Anybody can take. Devanjan, you have solved. You can answer. Riddhi, Ashish, anybody can answer. So basically here you can say ki all are true. That's all. Okay. So YAP1 fusion is also seen in supratentorial EPN and has a good prognosis. What is the answer? YAP1 fusion. Is it good or bad?
Good, sir.
Good.
It's good. Good. Very good. So at least I'm able to explain. So YAP1 is good. And what is bad in supratentorial? Anybody?
RELA,
sir.
Excellent. So RELA is bad, YAP1 is good. Very good. Very good. And among PFA and PFB, which is bad?
PFA
becomes bad when? What do you add?
1Q gain,
sir.
1Q gain is
amazing. Amazing. And the PFB is good, but when it really doesn't remains to be good, what is that loss?
13Q loss.
You all are just too good. Too good. This was another thing that the supratentorial RELA fusion and posterior fossa A, these are bad prognostic groups. Again, here incorrect answers were quite a lot. So RELA and PFA are bad. And ependymomas are known to have how many molecular subtypes?
Nine.
So 3 plus 3 plus 3, 9. Excellent. So that's one thing. Posterior fossa ependymoma have a high recurrence due to central location, which makes it difficult to resect. True, true answer is basically true, because it likes centrally and it is difficult to resect out. That's the thing. This entire thing, I've just taken the screenshot from what Santam has sent. It is not mine. Santam has done a great effort in compiling all this thing. I've just taken a screenshot. Ependymoma arises from supertentorial, infratentorial, and spinal cord.
All of them.
Here it becomes slightly difficult. Mixopapillary ependymomas are concerned. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Grade one.
Okay, so this is the result of because many people have attempted Kahoot by putting a nickname. So I don't know who is Marin. Who is Marin? Yeah, is Marin here? This nickname Marin. So Marin had scored the highest, that is 89%, with almost, this was the final score. And I don't know who is GI. Who is GI?
GI.
I don't want to exhibit that because we'll come to know. Stood second, Shobhna did third. Now, what is very interesting in that, even I had attempted and I'm not in the top 10. So that's very interesting. You know? So I'm not even in the top 10, despite I knew the answer. But you can understand that as you grow older, you start committing more mistakes despite having the answer papers. So I don't stand in the top 10 also. I could see Ashish and Debanjan over here. So that's the thing. So thank you so much. Thank you for patient listening. And
thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Amazing to hear from you all.